Hi everyone, I'm Federico, and welcome to the presentation of the paper, A Regret Analysis of Bilateral Trade. It is a joint work with Nicolò, Tommaso, Roberto, and Stefano. In this paper, we study learning in the bilateral trade problem from the perspective of regret minimization. So, let's start introducing the bilateral trade problem. Imagine that a seller and a buyer join an online platform to trade a good. The seller wants to sell a certain item at a price that is greater than some value S, while the buyer wants to buy the same item at a price smaller than some value B. Now, those two values are private information of the agent, and the goal of the mechanism designer is to design a platform that intermediates between the two agents and that is robust to their strategic behavior. Traditionally, there are four properties that we would like the platform to enforce. First, we would like to have individual rationality, meaning that the seller and the buyer should not lose money in the trade. Second, we would like to enforce the actual robustness to misreporting the valuation. So we would like the mechanism to enforce dominant strategy incentive compatibility, meaning that the agents are incentivized to report truthfully their valuations. Third, and this is like a property that is specific to this type of problem, we would like the mechanism to enforce strongly budget balance, meaning that at the end of the trade, there is no money that went from the platform to the agents or the other way around. So there is no subsidized nor money draining from the platform side. And finally, we would like our mechanism to be economically efficient, meaning that no trading opportunity has to be lost. Now, this is too good to be true. And in fact, there is this very famous impossibility theorem by Meyerson and Satterthwaite in the 80s that says that no mechanism satisfying the property from 1 to 4 exists. Actually, this impossibility result holds even when we ask for a weaker assumption. So when there is an underlying distribution determining the valuations of the seller and the buyer, these distributions are known to the mechanism designer, and all those property apart from the fourth one has to be enforced in expectation. And yes, that's it. And so, okay, we have this impossibility result. What do we do? Well, the typical approach is to say, okay, let's keep the first three conditions that enforce somehow robustness to misreporting and like make the mechanism something reasonable and implementable in practice. And let's try to weaken the assumption on efficiency. So let's aim at something that approximates the gain from trade. That is the difference in social welfare at the end of the trade. And later we will see a more precise definition of that. Now, before defining the gain from trade, in this paper, we focus on posted price mechanism that, given this theorem by Colini, Baldeschi, Kaiser, Leonardi, and Torchetta, fully characterize mechanism satisfying the first three properties we have seen before. And in posted price mechanism, we have that the mechanism proposes a price for the trade without consulting the agent. And once the mechanism posts the price, we can see that the gain from trade has a very nice interpretation. That is simply the difference between the buyer valuation and the seller valuation if actually the trade occurred. So if the price posted was actually between the seller and the buyer valuations. And so now that we have restricted ourselves without loss of generality to posted price mechanism, and we have defined gain from trade, we can state what is our goal. Our goal is to maximize the total gain from trade over a sequence of trades without using any preliminary information on buyers and seller valuations. So let's present more in detail the learning protocol. For each discrete time step T, a pair of seller and buyer arrives with hidden valuation ST and BT in the interval 0-1. Then the platform posts a certain price PT in the same interval. And finally, it only receives a certain feedback signal ZT that is function of ST, BT, and PT. Now, in this paper, we studied two different types of feedback. The full feedback one, that corresponds to direct revelation mechanism, where at the end of each round, both the seller and the buyer reveal their actual valuations. So this feedback is pretty rich, but a bit unrealistic, because after the trade happened or not, if the price is not good, there is no incentive for the seller and the buyer to reveal their actual valuation. And then we study also the realistic feedback that corresponds to positive price mechanism. And in this case, ZT is only given by two bits that specify the relative ordering between ST and PT and PT and BT. Now, this realistic feedback can be justified by imagining that both the seller and the buyer are separately proposed the price, and they both answer with a simple yes or no. And clearly, in the end, there is a trade if and only if both says yes. Now, once this feedback is received, the price at time t is determined using all the past feedback received, and possibly using some extra internal randomization of the algorithm. After the feedback model, there is still a degree of freedom that has to be specified, and it is relative to the different generation models of the sequence of valuations. We consider two cases: the adversarial setting, that is the more general one, where we want to be competitive against all possible unknown deterministic sequences of seller and buyer valuations. And then we consider the stochastic setting, where we assume that there is an unknown joint distribution over seller and buyer valuations, and at each time step, a fresh IID sample is drawn from it. Given these specifications of the model, we are ready to see what is our objective. That is simply regret minimization. So we want to devise a learning algorithm that minimizes the regret, that is the difference between the total gain from trade achieved by the algorithm and the total gain from trade of the best fixed price. And the main result of the paper, our contribution, is a full characterization of the different regret regimes achievable for the various combination of feedback model and sequence generation models. Now, in the rest of the talk, I will present this result, and then I will wrap up everything. So let's start with the most complex model, the adversarial model. So what we want to devise is a randomized algorithm that works well against all possible deterministic sequence of inputs. In this scenario, we have a very strong negative result. And we show that even in the full feedback case, there is no way one can get sublinear regret. In particular, given any algorithm, we construct a deterministic sequence of seller-buyer valuation such that the probability at each time t of pt being in the right interval is at most 1 over 2, meaning that with a probability at least 1 half, the algorithm will fail to trade. Then this sequence is such that there exists a price p star that makes trade in each single round, and then we show that the difference between BT and ST is at least a certain constant. Now, all these three ingredients are enough to claim that the regret of any algorithm is an omega of T, and this happens even under full feedback problem. So this lower bound closes the problem of dealing with regret minimization in the adversarial model. And as a technical feature, let me just mention that this sequence is built using the construction of Cantor's ternary set. So since the adversarial model is too hard, we study the stochastic IID setting, where there is an underlying IID distribution on the valuations, and the goal is to find the best, is still to find the best fixed price with respect to these valuations. Full feedback means that it is always possible for the algorithm to reconstruct the game from trade for different prices, and not only the price that was actually posted. Then it is possible to devise a follow the leader or follow the best price approach that gives a regret of square root t log t. The same result can be achieved using other techniques, but here we want to stress the similarity between this problem in the full feedback and prediction with expert. In fact, the square root t regret is actually tight, even with a weaker assumption on the valuations, and the reduction comes actually from the expert problem. In fact, it is possible to build two instances of the problem that mimic the behavior of the hard instance of the prediction with expert problem, where we have only two actions that correspond to two prices. Once we have closed the full feedback case as a warm-up, we tackle the hardest and more meaningful realistic feedback case, where at each time step t, only a minimal amount of feedback is received, namely two bits that express the relative ordering between st and pt and pt and bt. Now, before considering the positive result, we show that we need to assume that the distribution of ST and BT are independent, and moreover, that they both admit bounded density, because otherwise it is possible to build instances where no sublinear regret can be achieved. To get positive results in this case, what we exploit is a decomposition of the expected gain from trade of price P that has a very nice probabilistic interpretation if we resort to using a uniform random variable U. So the gain from trade can be expressed using these four terms, where the blue terms somehow contain the information about the expected value of B and S given that the train happened. And once we have that decomposition lemma, we can devise this algorithm, namely the scouting bandits, in the following way. An epsilon grid of prices is cast in the 0-1 interval, and then in an initial uniform exploration phases, the two blue terms are estimated using simple Monte Carlo techniques. And this can be done for each price P in the epsilon grid. Then in the rest of the time horizon. We just use our favorite bandit algorithm using the approximation we got in the first part to estimate the blue part of the game from trade at each time step t. Notice that this approach is meaningful because we assume bounded density, and hence the game from trade is Lipschitz. And this means that solving the problem of the grid gives something also for the whole interval 0-1. Here there is a sketch of the analysis, and we see that if we choose epsilon to be t to the minus 1/3, we get a regret of the order t to the 2/3 times log t. And actually, this regret is tight, and we show this via a reduction from the partial monitoring literature, in particular from the revealing action case. And in fact, we build this specific instance where the Bayer distribution is known and bounded, and there are two possible Seller distributions that are still bounded. And if we plot the two game from trade functions corresponding to these two options, so the red and the blue line, we see that there are three meaningful interval of prices that the algorithm can use. The red one and the blue one that are optimal in the relative instance, and the gray one that is the only interval that lets the algorithm learn in enough quickly to discriminate between these two instances. But since the regret in the gray area is constant, then one can show that the regret is actually of the order of t to the 2/3. And so, as we have seen that there is a correspondence between full feedback and prediction with expert, here we see that there is a strong correspondence between realistic feedback and the revealing action case in partial monitoring. In this last slide, let me just recap our results. First, we have seen that in the adversarial case, there is no hope to get sublinear regret. Then we have moved to the stochastic problem, and we have seen that in the full feedback case, square root t is the right regret. Finally, we have studied the realistic feedback case, and we have seen that t to the 2/3 is the tight regret that can be achieved if we assume that the random variables are independent and they admit bounded densities. I hope you enjoyed the talk. Thank you for your attention, and see you at the poster session.